And now we're going to switch gears to playing music to have our chat with Professor Keita. Professor Keita, are you on the line?
Yes, I'm on the line. Just landed in San Antonio.
Okay, very well.
Yeah.
All right, so let me introduce you. Professor Cherif Keita is a professor of literature at Carleton College in Minnesota. He teaches literature of Africa and the Caribbean written in French. He's an author. His book, Outcast to Ambassador, The Musical Odyssey of Cherif Keita, is available on Amazon. And now we can add filmmaker to his list of accomplishments, as he is the director of the documentary Remembering Nokutela, which tells the story of the life of the first wife of ANC founder John Dube. Professor Keita, I understand that it was an essay written by Nokutela Dube in the 19th century, which you found in your town in Minnesota, that first got you to notice who this person was. Can you expound on that essay and why you found it so compelling to pursue finding out who the author was?
Well, yes. I mean, it started with my not knowing anything about John Dube, the husband, first, whose name I heard for the first time when I visited South Africa with students in 1999, and became fascinated by this South African man who not only had founded the ANC, and but had also started a school in 1900. And it's on the ground of that school that Nelson Mandela voted for the first time in 1994. He traveled to Durban because of Lange, the school of John Dube, is located about 20 kilometers from there. So to learn that John Dube has studied in the U.S., and I became really fascinated by this man, and I decided to come back to the U.S. and do research about him. And it is from that point that I discovered that John Dube had connections to the town where I was living in Minnesota, in the sense that the missionary, white missionaries that brought him as a young 16-year-old boy to America in 1887, that the wife was from my town. So this is really how my research started 17 years ago. And so I found all those links and, you know, did research and made a film on John Dube, a first film which appeared, which I, you know, released in 2005, called Oberlin, Inanda, The Life and Times of John L. Dube. So that story was really, that film was focused on the life of John Dube. Now, the second film that I did was 4 years later. It was titled Cemetery Stories, A Rebel Missionary in South Africa. This was the story of the missionary that brought John Dube to America, so, and their connection to my town. But now I'm coming to Nokutela, because Nokutela, her essay had been published in Northfield, Minnesota in 1882, because Mrs. Wilcox, that's the name of the missionary lady, had sent this cool essay by a Zulu girl, a young Zulu girl, to her mother, to show the mother how dedicated the Zulu girls were and bright they were in learning English in just a few years. So it's that essay that I came across, you know, in my town, in the newspaper that no longer exists called the Rice County Journal.
Right.
It was titled My Home. And this young girl was speaking about her people and their way of life. And this was Nokutela, the future Mrs. Dube's essay. Her maiden name was Mdima, Nokutela Mdima. So finding that, after all those other coincidences that I already mentioned to you, was really the culmination of a process, but it took me to another level, because, I mean, it was as if this lady, whose existence I was aware of, because, I mean, I knew that she had been married to John Dube and was John Dube's first wife, and had built everything with John Dube. But her name was nowhere. She was not being mentioned anywhere, except in primary sources. So finding her essay in my town, I said that this lady had been calling me from the grave. You see, basically that's what, because she up to that time, I mean, she was unknown. She had spent almost, 95 years in anonymity. You know, people, her name was nowhere.
So this is how I
thought that really this lady was calling out to me to bring her name back, to bring her story back to her country, to South Africans, and also to Africans and to the world.
How was the essay preserved?
The essay was preserved on microfilm, you know, because the newspaper has been digitized. And some of the issues for certain years have burned out. Unfortunately, it seems to be a common story of newspapers, you know, in those days. But luckily, you know, I found the microfilm, and, Mrs. Wilcox had been writing letters to her mother, maybe once every 4 months. So I started picking up on, correspondence with her mother from the very first moment they arrived in South Africa in 1881. And up until 1882, that's when I lost track, because I think those issues were burned out.
Okay.
So it is on microfilm.
Now, did you feel a more spiritual, cosmic connection to Mrs. Dube than Mr. Dube?
Well, yes, definitely. Because, I mean, you know, it turns out that the lady, Mrs. Wilcox, Mrs. Wilcox's mother was buried, in fact, in a cemetery not too far from my house. Literally behind my bedroom, there was a cemetery.
In Minnesota.
There was just a church in Minnesota, in Northfield.
Northfield, yeah.
And this is the woman who had been buried there since, I think, 1905 or something, who had, you know, given the daughter's letter to the newspaper, along with the letter, this school essay. And to tell the truth, I mean, you know, Nokutela's grave was not, in living memory, nobody knew where Nokutela was buried. I found documents that said the cemetery where she was buried in Johannesburg, because people were expecting her to be buried somewhere in Natal. But she was buried in Johannesburg in 1917, so in one of the oldest cemeteries. So as soon as I found that information, I contacted the cemetery department, and they checked and found that her name was in the register. But they told me it's going to be a challenge finding her grave, because this part of the cemetery where black people were buried, people of color were buried, was almost like a bush. Totally, you know, not kept up at all. Broken headstone, in fact, no headstones. So they say it's going to be a challenge to find a grave. So it took us a year and a half, really, to find the grave, pinpoint it, you know, with the metal detectors and so forth. Yeah, so we started in 2009 looking for a grave. And, you know, by 2011, we found a grave. And when I got to Johannesburg, they called me, they say, we are going to show you the grave. So, in fact, the film opens with, you know, the grave being delineated for me. You see?
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, definitely there is a deep spiritual connection with this lady.
Right. Now, Professor, you know, in your film, you have tried to highlight and show to the world that Mrs. Dube was as much as a foundational builder of a lot of South African institutions and culture, as her husband was. And since her memory was erased from history, but what I wanted to do is, if you can enumerate just a few, if two or three or four specific items that she built that still last today to her legacy.
Okay, very good. You know, the best-known school, I mean, that they started in 1900, is called the Oklange Institute.
Yes.
The Oklange Institute was the school for which they raised funds between 1896 and 1899 on the East Coast and different parts of the United States to go build the school on the model of a very well-known school in the U.S. here called the Tuskegee Institute.
Uh-huh.
Built by African-American leader, Booker T. Washington, yes, who had a great influence around the world. So this school was an industrial education school meant to teach black people skills that they could use to set up independent and small businesses for themselves. That was the same principle here in the U.S. that Booker T. Washington had expounded. So, you know, they started this school in 1900. In fact, I just a month ago, I visited the South Africa again, KwaZulu-Natal, and I had always heard about the first school they started even before Otlange, which they started in 1894 in a small village called Ngwadi in KwaZulu-Natal. Finally, I had a chance a month ago to go visit the school. That school is still standing. So, in fact, so one can say that they were the first black people to ever start a school in South Africa.
I see.
And that school is still standing. I mean, that elementary school is still standing in that small village. So those two schools were history-making schools. We know that the Otlange Institute is where Albert Luthuli, the first African to be awarded a Nobel Prize, that's where he went to school, Albert Luthuli, and he was the president of the ANC in the 1960s. Okay, so and the school trained so many leaders in so many fields in South Africa who went on to do business for themselves and thrive, and became the pillars of the nationalist liberation later. Mm-hmm. Okay, so and over there at that school, they had a tradition of music making, which gave rise to great names in music. In fact, some as close to us as Busi Mhlongo, she went to Otlange.
Mm-hmm.
So she inherited the musical tradition started by John and Nokutela at Otlange since the 1900s. Okay, so now moving on to another achievement,
yes,
was that in 1903, on the ground of the school, they started a newspaper, English Zulu newspaper called Ilanga Lase Natal. This newspaper is published to this day.
It is published to this day?
To this day. Ilanga is published to this day.
Yeah.
You see. So the school exists to this day.
Yes.
The newspaper exists to this day. The two schools exist to this day. Okay. And then, of course, in 1912, you know, she supported her husband working to launch the ANC, which was at that time called the South African Native National Congress.
Okay.
So, again, she was involved indirectly, at least in supporting her husband's political work.
Right. So now, Professor...
And in fact, it is thanks to her that the song known today as Nkosi Sikelela Africa,
right,
which is the anthem of
God
South Africa today.
Africa.
See, that's why. She is the one who popularized the song. She did not compose it.
Right.
The song was composed by Enoch Sontonga, who was a Methodist pastor, but a very shy person. So when John and Nokutela heard this song, they realized that this song really embodied the philosophy, their philosophy of enabling Africans to help themselves, to be self-supporting and to be able to self-determine, you see. So by Africa being able to blow her own horn, you see, by finding your own way to God without anybody's intercession or without anybody's supervision, you see what I mean?
Yes.
So this was really the spirit of independence. The song embodied that. So when they heard this song, they got permission from Enoch Sontonga to take this song. And in fact, they crafted their own lyrics to it. And the lyrics in those days said, you know, among other things, the refrain is the same. It says, God bless the son of Dube, that's John Dube, as he goes to speak to the white. We pray for him as he crosses the ocean, the seas. You see. So this was really a song, and it was called in those days, Prayer for the Children at Otlange. Prayer for the Children of Otlange. This was their school. So that's how South Africans knew this song for decades.
Okay,
you know,
Professor.
Before it became adopted by the ANC as the anthem of the struggle.
Okay, wonderful. Now, you just enumerated four lasting,
yes,
legacies that,
right,
Mrs. Nokutela built. First of all, two schools,
yes,
that are still standing,
right,
then a,
yes,
newspaper that is still publishing, then the,
that's
ANC,
right,
that is still the national, the winning party of South Africa, and also popularizing the song Kosi Sikelele Africa. All of these are still standing from today. And so why? Why do you think such a builder as this woman was erased from history?
Well, you see, it was due to family tragedy. Nokutela was never able to have a child. So they were married in 1894. This is when they were married. And by 1914, they had not had a child yet. So this was a tragedy. I mean, as they were building things in their private lives, there was this pain. So one cannot excuse what John did, but John, I think, went on the side and did some and committed infidelity. You see, and luckily, I mean, it was a scandal that was quelled a bit by the early death of that child. The child didn't live long, but still, the harm was done. Nokutela felt betrayed by her husband and decided to leave everything behind, everything she had built. She left everything behind and left her husband, left her own family living in the area, and went to live in a different part of South Africa, in the Eastern Transvaal. And that's where she was preaching, you know, the gospel on farms where blacks were, you know, working on wool, you know, Africana farms, and the very tough conditions. So she went really to bring solace to these people, you know, for the last 3 years. That was 1914 that she left her husband. By 1917, that's when she became very ill. And, you know, they were still married. And at that time, they owned a house in Sophiatown, the famous Sophiatown.
Mm.
Because John, as the president of the ANC, and also as the president of the Black Farmers Association, so he had a lot of business in the Johannesburg area. So it made sense for them to have a home there. So when John heard that his wife was sick, he sent somebody to that part of South Africa, Eastern Transvaal, to bring Nokutela. And Nokutela, unfortunately, lost the battle very quickly and died on January 25th, 1917. I mean, almost a century ago, can you imagine? And then on the 26th of January, she was buried. And at her burial, at the Brixton Cemetery, I mean, all the people that mattered in those days, you know, in politics and in mining, you know, in you know, were there at her burial. People like Pixley Seme, Alfred Mangena, you know, one of the first black lawyers. I mean, they were all at a funeral.
Right. So,
this was the ANC.
So
that's when Nokutela died, the page was turned on her, because John married 3 years later, in 1920, and all the descendants came from the second wife.
Okay.
So it was Malo. Not really in any... That's from Marco Malo, that's right. See? So that's where, you know, with decades passing, people just, you know, forgot her.
Right.
You know, by the time I started the research in her own family, among her, in her extended family.
Yes.
I mean, ladies in their 70s did not know where this ancestor of theirs was buried. I am the one who took the news to them, and I'm the one who took them to the place of burial, and then we started doing, you know, placing a gravestone. Because she, in 95 years, she had never had a name written on her grave.
Yeah, that's something that fascinated me when I looked at your film.
Very sad.
Remembering Nokutela. There was some kind of a way that they categorized people who died and put a kind of a code or a number on the gravestone instead of their name. Can you tell us about that? Because hers was C something, you know, or K something.
Yeah. People in the apartheid, people were not the same in life. They were not the same in death either.
Mm.
So every group had to be put in his own place, in a cemetery. So when Nokutela died in 1917, all she had on her grave, and that later disappeared, you know, because it corroded, okay, was a little plaque that said CK
2973.
That's right. Which meant Christian, the K Kafir,
Kafir
is the N-word.
Yes, in South Africa.
So this is a woman who had done so much for people. Okay?
Yes.
When she died, all she had on her grave was a little thing sticking out, a little piece of metal with those letters and those numbers.
Uh-huh.
And when those corroded and disappeared, literally she was lying in an unmarked grave.
Mm.
And, you know, for 95 years, when we found her grave, this is the state we found it in. There was no name on it. It was just bush. We had to dig to even identify, you know, the concrete block, you see.
Okay.
So, I mean, all her dignity had been taken away from her.
Mm. Now, Professor
Keita, she is really, in a sense, the poster girl for the marginalization of women in African history.
Yes.
And, in fact, in world history.
Marginalization. It's
exactly,
true.
Because they become simply footnotes in the... you know, in a page of the great epic of a brave man. See,
you know,
so,
whenever
so we have
I,
to find her, yes.
Whenever I communicate with people virtually on the internet from South Africa, and I'm talking to them or tweeting to them or communicating with them about your film, and then I tell them, oh, check YouTube here for this video of Professor Keita promoting his film on PRI,
very short
BBC
piece,
or whatever. You know, one of their reactions is that they feel ashamed that a foreigner, meaning you coming from Mali, is coming to South Africa to unearth their history for them. Can you speak briefly, because we only have about 3 minutes, about how you feel about that reaction?
Well, you see, I mean, it's African history. You know, I am an African, so South African history is Africa's history. And there is no shame in not knowing this history, because we know why people don't know it.
Yeah.
Because the apartheid system was such that it discouraged the teaching of this kind of thing. And in fact, it prevented it. Okay? So, I mean, when you grow up under those conditions, I mean, we know the school system, you know, and the apartheid, the Bantu education, was education for servitude.
Okay.
So therefore, I mean, the brilliant models of black leadership were not part of that education. So they should not feel ashamed. In fact, I feel that it was my duty as an African intellectual living in the West, being paid to do what I like doing the most, the research. You know, it was my duty to do this.
Okay.
You see, because, I mean, you know, Nokutela, in fact, is a model for humanity, not just for Africa, but for humanity.
Very good.
So
Professor,
I believe that, you know, we should all celebrate this history.
Right.
And it doesn't matter who brought it, you know.
Exactly.
And in fact, I mean, you know, I've been doing this research for 17 years about missionaries, but I'm a Muslim.
Okay. Now, we're out of time. I'm so sorry.
Yes.
But tell the listeners to this broadcast
right
now all over the world, WBAI and WBAI.org, where we can buy your film.
Yes. It's on a website called MediaLabAfrica.com. MediaLabAfrica.com.
MediaLabAfrica.com.
That's why all my films are there. And, you know, for Nokutela, there'll be, right now there is an institutional prize. It's being sold at an institutional price. But
institutional
pretty soon
price.
We'll have, a lower price for individuals buying it. But the three films are available.
I dare say that, you know, this is a good film for premium for WBAI doing fundraising. And hopefully next time there is a fundraiser at WBAI, we'll call upon you to help us, to provide us with some of the films at the institution.
Wonderful.
Place.
I love
Wonderful.
To do that.
It's been
Thank
great.
You so
Thank
much.
You so much.
Thank you, Akena.
All right.
Good luck. Bye-bye. Thanks.
And you have been listening to Professor Cherif Keita of Carleton College in Minnesota, talking about his film, Remembering Nokutela.